Hi guys, welcome to Sourcing Classes. This is Hima Hegde, presenting before you the weekly news podcast under the brand new series wherein we cover up and present before you all the relevant articles for the week, along with the facts and snippets thereby. To grab the best of it, stay tuned. To begin with, let us look at the topics under light for today. We have the Rudram 1 missile, the Swamitva scheme, Blue Flag Beaches, Rashtriya Kamadhenu Ayog, and the Asian Development Bank. Firstly, Rudram 1 missile. Here are the snapshots of the newspaper headlines on Rudram 1 missile. They read, India successfully test fires DRDO's Rudram anti-radiation missile. Country's first indigenous anti-radiation missile successfully tested. So Rudram 1 missile is India's first indigenous anti-radiation missile. So what is an anti-radiation missile? What these anti-radiation missiles do is, they detect, track and neutralize the adversary's radar. An adversary is an opponent or the enemy in case of a dispute or a conflict. So it will neutralize the adversary's radar. Also the communication assets and other radio frequency sources, which are generally their air defense systems, a part of their air defense systems. They also can locate and target. They can locate and target any radiation emitting source, that is a radioactive element. Further, most importantly, they play a key role in neutralizing any jamming platforms of the enemy. Now, what does this mean, jamming platforms? So basically, a jamming attack is when the opponent would intentionally send out radio frequency signals to interfere with the operation of the radar by saturating its receiver with noise or false information. So now they play a key role in neutralizing these jamming platforms. Whenever such situation would take place, it would take out the radar situation, thereby clearing the path for our own fighters to carry out an offense. Also thereby preventing any kind of jamming. So this is about the anti-radiation missile. Rudram 1 is also an anti-radiation missile. It is basically an air-to-surface missile, also called as the air-to-ground missile. So what are these? Now these are the missiles designed to be launched from military aircraft at targets on land or sea. As we have already seen, Rudram 1 is the first indigenous anti-radiation missile. Coming to its capability, once the missile locks on the target, it is capable of striking accurately, even if the radiation force switches off in between. So accurate striking is one of its best capabilities. Talking of its features, we have the missile integrated with SU-30 MKI aircraft. Now this is basically a unit of fighter jets. So when integrated with this, it has the capability of varying ranges based on the launch conditions. It can be adapted for launch from other fighter jets as well. It can be launched from the altitudes of 500 meter to 15 kilometer and speeds of 0.6 to 2 Mach. Significance. Rudram has been developed for the Indian Air Force. Rudram has been developed for the Indian Air Force requirement to enhance the suppression of enemy air defense capability, SEAD. So what exactly is this? Now this is the combat activities of attacking the enemy air defense system. Furthermore, the modern day warfare is becoming more network centric. Network centric means that it comprises of elaborate detection, surveillance and communication systems which are integrated with the network systems. And Rudram would serve the right purpose in this case. Indigenously developed weapon systems. This is yet another test of indigenously developed weapon systems in addition to the recent test of the Shaurya missile or the HSTDV. We have already discussed about what is HSTDV in one of our previous videos. It is an unmanned scramjet vehicle. Now with this, the country has established indigenous capability to develop long-range air-launched anti-radiation missiles for neutralizing the enemy radars, communication and other emitting targets. So that's about it. Moving on, we have the Swamitva scheme. This is mostly factual, so I have dropped the relevant facts before you. The headlines read, PM Modi to launch property cards under the Swamitva scheme soon. Swamitva to bring historical change in villages across the country, says Prime Minister. So what is the Swamitva scheme? Firstly, Swamitva stands for Survey of Villages and Mapping with Improvised Technology in Village Areas. Now this scheme is a collaborative effort of the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, State Panchayati Raj Departments, State Revenue Departments and the Survey of India. Coming to the aim, it aims at providing an integrated property validation, solution for rural India. It is basically a scheme for mapping the land parcels. To explain it in simple words, what it does is the mapping of the land parcels in rural inhabited areas using the drone technology and continuously operating reference station, that is CORS. Now, CORS is basically a network of reference stations which will provide a virtual base station which will allow the users to access long-range high-accuracy network connections. So, it basically is all about the mapping of the land in the rural areas. Coming to the benefits of the same, the scheme will help in streamlining the planning and revenue collection in rural areas and will thus ensure the clarity on property rights. The scheme will enable creation of better quality Gram Panchayat development plans, that is also abbreviated as GPDPs. It will enable the creation of better quality Gram Panchayat development plans using the maps which are created under this. Now this will be a participatory process. Now this program is currently implemented in 6 states, that is Haryana, Karnataka, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Uttar Pradesh and Uttarakhand. All in all, according to the statement given by the Prime Minister of India, millions of rural property owners will benefit from the first of its kind scheme that involves the most modern means of technology. So that's about it with the Swamitva scheme. Next online, we have the Blue Flag Beaches. So the headlines read, in a first, 8 Indian beaches accredited with the Blue Flag Certificate. With the Blue Flag Certificate, 8 Indian beaches awarded the International Blue Flag Certification, all about the Ecolabel. So this speaks about 8 Indian beaches that have bagged the coveted Ecolabel Blue Flag, the label that is Blue Flag. It is a title given from the international agency called the Foundation for Environment Education, that is the FEE, headquartered in Denmark. So to repeat, 8 Indian beaches have got this title or the label called Blue Flag from the international agency, that is the Foundation for Environment Education, FEE. Before we look into what exactly is the Blue Flag certification or the Blue Flag label, let us see what these 8 beaches are. Here the map consists of 12 beaches in total. So these were the ones that were recommended for the Blue Flag certification. Among these, the ones that have bagged the Ecolabel are the Shivrajpur Beach of Gujarat, the Ghogala Beach of Daman and Diu, the Padubidri and Kasargod Beach in Karnataka, the Kappad Beach in Kerala, the Radhanagar Beach in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, the Rushikonda Beach of Andhra Pradesh and the Golden Beach of Odisha. So, what exactly is the Blue Flag certification? The Blue Flag beaches are considered to be the cleanest beaches of the world. The Blue Flag beaches are considered to be the cleanest beaches of the world. Now, the Blue Flag is one of the world's most recognized voluntary ecolabels awarded to the beaches, marinas, and sustainable boating tourism operators. So, this certification is provided not only to the beaches but also to the marinas. A marina is nothing but a dock or the basin where all these repair activities, supply related work, and the operational activities for the yacht or the boats are done. Moving on, in order to qualify for the Blue Flag certification, stringent environmental, educational, safety and accessibility criteria have to be met and maintained. The Blue Flag program for beaches and marinas is run by the international non-governmental non-profit organization called the FEE, that is the Foundation for Environmental Education. Now the most important point here would be that on the lines of the Blue Flag certification, India has launched its own ecolabel. Something similar to this, India has launched its own ecolabel called the BEAMS. Now, what is BEAMS? BEAMS stands for Beach Environment and Aesthetics Management Services. This is an eco-label launched by India indigenously. Let us look at its objectives. Firstly, abate pollution in the coastal areas, in the coastal waters. Secondly, to promote sustainable development, to promote sustainable development of the beach facilities. Then, to protect and conserve the coastal ecosystems and the natural resources. Needless to say, strive and maintain high standards of cleanliness. Lastly, to ensure the hygiene and safety for the beach goers in accordance with the coastal environment and regulations. So we have seen what exactly is the blue certification, the blue flag certification. We have looked into what 8 beaches bear the same eco label or the title. And then we have also looked at India's own eco label called BEAMS and what are its objectives. So that's about it with this article. Next online, we have the Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog. The headlines read, 33 crore cow dung diyas to hit markets this Diwali to counter Chinese light, says the Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog. Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog chief said that, the chip made of cow dung significantly reduces the radiation from the phone. So the common denominator out of these headlines would be the utility of cow dung or the cow products and the Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog. So what is this? So the Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog was created for the conservation, protection and development of cows and their progeny, that is their children. So in other words, this is to ensure the conservation of cows. This is to ensure the conservation of cows and their development for their welfare, that is the welfare of the cows. It comes under the Ministry of Fisheries, Animal Husbandry and Dairying. This will lead to an increase in the growth of the livestock sector. The Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog, will work in collaboration with the veterinary, the animal sciences or agricultural university or the departments or organization of central or state government engaged in the task in research in the field of breeding and rearing of the cow, organic manure, biogas, etc. So all in all, to put it in a nutshell, the Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog is aimed at conserving or protecting the cows and carry out certain developmental activities or developmental programs that will lead to the welfare of them and their progeny. So what is the significance of it? Needless to say, this would create or generate business opportunities for the thousands of cow-based entrepreneurs or farmers. And the use of cow dung will also lead to a cleaner and healthier environment. The Rashtriya Kamadhenu Aayog will function as an integral part of the Rashtriya Gokul Mission, and this will serve in boosting the Make in India vision. As we have already seen, it would generate opportunities for the cow-based entrepreneurs in India. Thus, it would boost the Make in India vision. Looking at the functions, we have optimum economic utilization. This would suggest measures for optimum economic utilization of cow wealth for enhanced production and productivity. Now, this would lead to higher farm income and better quality life of the farmers or the cow-based entrepreneurs. So we have already seen about the development of business opportunities in this field. Now, thus, it would lead to the growth of economy, that is the optimum economic utilization, which will lead to the better income and the better quality of life. This would advise and guide the central and state government policy matters concerning the conservation, protection, development and welfare of the cows and their progeny. This will also promote schemes to encourage the use of organic manure and recommend suitable measures including the incentive schemes for the use of dung or urine of the cow, in organic manure. Now how would this help? This will minimize the use of chemical fertilizers and hence reduce the pollution. And we have already seen in one of the headlines talking about how the use of cow dung based chips could reduce the radiation in phones, and also the cow dung made diyas could replace the Chinese made diyas, the China made diyas in the markets this year. So this would easily create more economic opportunities in our own country. Most importantly, this would make provisions for solutions to the problems related to the abandoned cows in the country by providing technical inputs to all these goshalas and gosadhans. So that's about it. We have the Asian Development Bank, ADB. The headlines read, Asian Development Bank and the government, that is the government of India, ink $570 million deal on loan agreement. ADB and India signed $300 million loan to support Rajasthan's town development. The statistics or the figures are not important from the examination perspective. However, that is the Asian Development Bank, comes under the important international institutes part of the syllabus in the General Studies 2 paper. Asian Development Bank. What is the Asian Development Bank? It is basically a regional development bank which was established in the 1960s. Again, the year is not important, it is just for your information. So it is a regional development bank which is headquartered in Manila, Philippines. It is an official United Nations observer. The Asian Development Bank is an official UN observer. So let us look at who can be its members. So firstly, the Asian Development Bank admits the members of United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and Pacific, that is the UNESCAP. It admits the members of the UNESCAP, formerly called as the Economic Commission for Asia and Far East, that is the ECAF. It admits the members of the UNESCAP and the non-regional developed countries. As of now, the Asian Development Bank has 68 members, out of which 49 are from within Asia. Let us now look at the voting rights. It is modeled closely to the World Bank. The voting rights of the Asian Development Bank are similar to that of the voting rights, the system of voting rights in the World Bank. That is, they both have a weighted voting system. Now, what exactly is a weighted voting system? So here, it is something where the votes are distributed in proportion with the members' capital subscriptions. So that is how the voting goes in both the ADB as well as the World Bank. So here are some statistics given. As of 31st December 2019, ADB's five largest shareholders are Japan, United States, each with 15.6% of the total shares, the People's Republic of China, India, and Australia. It is important to know that India is one of the top five shareholders in the Asian Development Bank. Coming to its roles and functions, it is dedicated to reducing the poverty in Asia and Pacific through inclusive economic growth. This is the concept which provides equitable opportunities for all the participants during the economic growth with the benefits incurred by every section of the society. So that is the inclusive economic growth. Also, the environmentally sustainable growth. Environmentally sustainable growth is nothing but utilizing the resources from the environment in a way that doesn't cause any harm to the natural resources and conserving them for the future generations. And regional integration. Now, regional integration is a process in which the neighboring states enter into an agreement in order to upgrade the cooperation. So this, to repeat, the Asian Development Bank is dedicated to reducing the poverty in Asia and Pacific through inclusive economic growth, environmentally sustainable growth, and regional integration. Now, how would this be possible? This could be achievable or this could be carried out through investments. Investments in the form of loans, grants, and information sharing in the infrastructure, health, that is the healthcare services, financial and public administration systems. So this would help the nations prepare for the impact of the climate change or better manage their natural resources as well as other areas. So that's with the significance of the same. So that's about it with the Asian Development Bank. Now we have something called as the Fast Five, where I'll be walking you through five snippets or five facts for the week which have their relevance in the preliminary examination. So to start with, Goa declared first Har Ghar Jal state in India. Now, the Jal Jeevan mission aimed at ensuring Har Ghar Jal to all the rural households by 2024. Now, Goa has become the first It has become the first Har Ghar Jal state in the country by providing tap water connection to every rural household in the state. The state has provided tap water connection to about 230,000 households. 230,000 rural households. Next, we have something called as the Marumani. Now, Marumani is a unique and innovative social media campaign. It is a social media campaign. Basically, Marumani means jewels of desert. Now, before we look into the objective, it was something launched by the Lok Samvad Samsthan. Lok Samvad Samsthan, which is a Jaipur-based media advocacy organization in collaboration with the APJ Institute of Mass Communication, New Delhi. Now, what exactly is this campaign? That is Marumani. So, the objective or the campaign seeks to raise financial support. It seeks to raise financial support for the famed musicians of desert districts of Rajasthan who are suffering severe hardships due to the prolonged corona crisis and accompanying lockdown, particularly the Langa Manganir folk artists of the western Rajasthan. So that's about it. Next, we have something called as SIAA, that is the Skull International Air Asia. This is about the 50th annual SIAA Congress in 2021. So what is the Skull International organization? Now this is a professional organization promoting global tourism and friendship, uniting all the sectors of the tourism industry. It also works at improving the business network worldwide. So basically, the Skull International organization has three hands, that is promoting tourism, the global tourism, friendship and business opportunities or the business network. It is the world's largest global network of tourism. It is a member of the UNWTO, that is the United Nations World Tourism Organization. Skull International holds an annual World Congress, every year in different country. Next, we have something called as the Fazolicin. What is Fazolicin? Now, this is a new antibiotic. It is a new antibiotic discovered in the soil of the tropical rainforest. It is found in the root nodules of wild beans, and this unusual antibiotic is produced by symbiotic soil bacterium. Symbiotic bacteria as in the one which lives or lives symbiotically with an other organism, that is it coexists or is dependent on another organism. So now this is produced by symbiotic soil bacterium using nitrogen fixation. So nitrogen fixation is the process by which the molecular nitrogen in the air is converted into ammonia, that is NH3. N2 is converted into NH3. What are the benefits of it? That is the benefits of this antibiotic called the Fazolicin. Not only could this antibiotic attack a diverse group of bacterial cells, but it could also enter the bacteria and bind to its ribosomes. By doing this, it would be messing with its ability to synthesize proteins. So that's how it would work. Next, we have the national butterfly. A citizen poll to identify the national butterfly has concluded with three species garnering the highest number of votes. So firstly, what was this poll? The nationwide poll was organized by the National Butterfly Campaign Consortium. So this is a group or a collective of 50 butterfly experts and enthusiasts. And what next? That is, the organizers after the poll will be submitting the names of the top three butterfly species identified or selected to the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. The onus is on the center to choose one of them to join the ranks of the Great Bengal Tiger, the Indian Peacock, the Indian Lotus, Banyan Tree and Mango. So this will receive the status or the title of the National Butterfly. Now what are the three species? We have the Krishna Peacock Butterfly, we have the Indian Jezebel and we have the Orange Oak Leaf. Now all these have unique features, such as this one has the ability to camouflage as a deadly. They also have the ability to stay off predators and aid farmers in getting rid of the pests. So with this, we have come to an end of the Fast Five and also Weekly News Podcast.
We have come to an end of today's session. Hope you found it informative. For more information and details or the documents for the current affairs, visit the official Sourcing Classes website, that is www.sourcingclasses.com.